This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. In previous classes, we discussed regarding the cirrhosis, acute alcoholic liver disease, and its complications like cirrhosis and its like hepatic encephalopathy. So now today, another important topic that is portal hypertension, which is one of the most important complications that should be remembered in the case of cirrhosis of liver. So this is an important short note question, portal hypertension. So kindly try to concentrate. First, before going actually into the person in the portal hypertension topic in topic, we briefly will see the anatomy. So how is the portal vein is formed and what are its tributaries, everything. See, the portal vein is formed in the front of inferior vena cava and behind the neck of the pancreas at the level of second lumbar vertebrae by the union of splenic vein and superior mesenteric vein. The portal vein is about 5 to 8 centimeters in length and 1 centimeter in diameter in adults and divide of valves. So it is valveless. It runs within the free border of the lesser omentum as a part of porta hepatis, posterior to the common bile duct and hepatic artery. So what are its tributaries? The main its tributaries are the coronary, that is left gastric, gastric vein, pyloric vein, cystic vein, pancreaticodiodial vein, ligamentum teres, that is umbilical vein. So these are the branches. You can see portal vein is formed by the union of the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein together form the portal vein. So what are this portosystemic anastomosis? So just remember, so what are the sites of this anastomosis? That is at the gastroesophageal junction, rectum, umbilicus, bare area of the liver, retroperitoneum. So this is see the portal vein tributaries and the systemic vein. So what is it? Why should remember this portosystemic anastomosis means what happens means in cirrhosis of liver, because of the distortion of the architecture of the liver, these vasculature gets distorted. So what happens is, you know, the blood does not flow properly normally through the liver. So what happens is takes a diversion, that is shunting of the blood. So this systemic anastomosis, so this takes the diversion of the blood. Further, these are helpful in that formation. So these anastomoses are formed as a result of this pathology, that is the cirrhosis of liver. That's why it takes a diversion. The blood takes diversion from entering into the distorted liver, that is the cirrhosis of liver. So this is briefly about the portal vein anatomy and its tributaries and what are its branches and how is it. Now coming to the topic, that is portal hypertension. So if what is portal hypertension? So normal portal venous pressure is, that is 5 to 10 mm of mercury. So it is defined as increase in portal venous pressure above the normal limit, that is more than 5 to 10 mm Hg. So it is also defined as hepatovenous pressure gradient, that is greater than 5 mm of Hg. As an undergraduate level, you may not remember this hepatovenous pressure gradient, you may not understand, but just remember that this venous normal pressure is 5 to 10 mm of Hg, and if it pressure is more than that of 10 mm of Hg, then it is defined as portal hypertension, and it's also defined in the terms of hepatic venous pressure gradient, that is more than 5 mm of Hg. So what is hepatovenous pressure gradient? The hepatic venous pressure gradient is the wedged hepatic venous pressure, difference of the wedged hepatic venous pressure and free hepatic venous pressure, that is nothing but the hepatic venous pressure gradient. So it is a measure of portal sinusoidal pressure and is obtained by catheterization of a hepatic vein via the jugular or femoral vein. So the normal hepatovenous pressure gradient value is 3 to 5 mm of mercury. So this is how it is measured, that is my hepatovenous pressure gradient is measured, that is the difference of wedge hepatovenous pressure minus free hepatic venous pressure. So nothing but there is normal is 3 mm of Hg. So if it is more than that of 5 mm of Hg, then it is termed as the portal hypertension. So measurement. So what is its significance? So if it is 1 to 1 mm of Hg, as I mentioned, it is normal. So what happens if the hepatic pressure venous pressure gradient increases, that is at the level of 6 to 10 mm of Hg, it is a preclinical sinusoidal portal hypertension. If it is more than 10 mm of Hg, then it is defined as clinically significant portal hypertension. And if it is more than 12 mm of mercury, there is an increased risk of rupture of varices. And if there is greater than 16 mm of Hg, there is increased risk of mortality. If it is greater than 20 mm of Hg, treatment failure and mortality in acute varices and bleeding. So coming to the etiology, so portal hypertension, etiology wise, it may be prehepatic, portal vein thrombus. So prehepatic means that is per se in the portal vein, that is portal vein thrombosis, splenic vein thrombosis, and compression of portal vein. So what this term exactly prehepatic means, before entering into the liver, so what is my portal vein is formed by, this is superior mesenteric vein and splenic vein, these together combined to form the portal vein. So the per se within the portal vein, if there is any pathology or the abnormality, then it is called as prehepatic. So some of the causes that may lead to the portal hypertension, prehepatic are portal vein thrombosis, that thrombus within the portal vein, and if the thrombus that occurs within the splenic vein, and the compression of portal vein. So coming to the intrahepatic. So intrahepatic, again, it's in the sinusoid and pre-sinusoid and post-sinusoid. So pre-sinusoidal, there may be like a parasitic infection like cystosomiasis, and sinusoidal, as I discussed in previous classes regarding the cirrhosis of liver, and the post-sinusoidal, that is vein occlusive disease. So coming to the post-hepatic causes, the post-hepatic causes, three constitute the post-hepatic causes, that is Budd-Chiari syndrome, veno-caval webs, constrictive pericarditis. So portal hypertension in, so what happens in cirrhosis exactly means, this portal hypertension in cirrhosis results in what exactly be increased resistance to portal flow at the level of the sinusoids, that is sinusoid. Why? As I mentioned earlier, I have said these things, that because the architecture of the hepatocyte, these get distorted. As a result, this architecture distorted, and also the fibrosis occurs within the hepatocyte. So because of this fibrosis, there is a constriction of all the vasculature. So what happens? Because of the constriction, there will be resistance will be increasing within the vasculature. So it resists the blood flow from the portal vein into the liver. So this is how there is increased resistance to portal flow at the level of the sinusoid, that is sinusoid. If the compression of the central veins by the periventricular fibrosis and expanded parenchymal nodules, that is post-sinusoidal. And coming to the pathophysiology of this portal hypertension, you can see that block to the portal flow leads to increased portal pressure, splanchnic vascular bed response, and initial increased vasoconstrictor response. Secondarily, vasodilator response dominates, which increases splanchnic blood flow, development of collaterals between portal and systemic circulation. So in the anatomy part, I have said this portosystemic anastomosis, why they are important means, because there is increase in the vascular resistance, what happens is there will be collaterals. So because blood will be trying to divert, so what happens is these collaterals will open. So where were these collaterals formed? This between the portal vein and also the systemic circulation. These gets get interconnected, so the blood will be diverted. So the plasma volume expansion occurs with the development of systemic hypodynamic circulation. So coming to the clinical features and complications, so what are the clinical features? Important features are, the important presenting features of portal hypertension are splenomegaly, esophagesis, ascites. Remember these three. These three are very, very important. So why it is these three occur? Because what happens means, in the portal, if there is any pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal, or post-sinusoidal pathology within the liver, what happens is the portal hypertension develops. So if the portal hypertension develops, what happens? The backflow of the blood increases. As a result, the spleen gets congested, and also there will be esophageal varices will be congested, and there will be leakage of the fluid, that is formation of ascites, that is splenomegaly, esophageal varices, and ascites. But in case of severe cases, it can progress to hepatorenal syndrome, hepatopulmonary syndrome, and hepatic encephalopathy. What exactly means this hepatorenal syndrome is, what happens is, because of this ascites, there will be leakage of fluid from the vasculature, so there will be hypertension. So hypertension per se, this is not hypertension, but that exactly means there will be overall volume content of the vasculature volume will be reduced. So because the volume decreased, because of this leakage which results in the ascites, this decreased blood within the vasculature results into the decreased renal plasma flow. So what happens if the blood flow to the kidney decreases? There will be decreased GFR. So if there is decreased GFR, what happens? The patient will be resulting in the acute kidney injury. So this is what, because this renal pathology is not because of per se within the pathology of the liver, kidney. Because of the ascites which developed due to the cirrhosis, what happens? Because of this ascites, the overall volume of the vasculature gets decreased. As a result, the blood flow to the kidney decreased, and as a result, decreased pathology occurs. So this pathology within the kidney is secondary to the clear liver. So that is why it is named as hepatorenal syndrome. So coming to the, we'll see in detail, that is one of the first clinical features, that is splenomegaly. What happens is congestive splenomegaly, because of the portal hypertension, the blood within the vasculature gets pulled up. As a result, there will be congestion within the spleen. As a result, there will be splenomegaly, and is most common and most consistent finding in patients with portal hypertension. It is congestive splenomegaly, and patients may develop thrombocytopenia and leukopenia. Why thrombocytopenia? Because there will be congestion, there will be no free flow, as well as the platelets will be get destroyed. So there will be thrombocytopenia. And splenomegaly itself usually require no specific treatment. So only treatment is in the long-standing cases, if there is anemia because of the secondary splenomegaly, what happens? We have to simply go for splenectomy. And after going with splenectomy, what happens, there will be pneumococcal infections. So for the prevention of those pneumococcal infections, we should give a vaccination for these people. So because these are most commonly in old age people, these vaccine pneumococcal infections. So in the patients who underwent the splenectomy, they should be vaccinated. Coming to the second important feature of portal hypertension, that is increased movement of, that is ascites, increased movement of intravascular fluid into the space of DC caused by sinusoidal hypertension and hypoalbuminemia, and this leakage of fluid from hepatic interstitium into the peritoneal cavity, that is blockade of lymph radicals, and the renal retention of sodium and water due to secondary hyperaldosteronism. So these will present with distended abdomen or breathlessness in massive ascites. So what exactly ascites means? So if you see the abdomen of the normal person or an abnormal person, if you compare the patient with ascites and the patient with the normal person, this abdominal girth will be less in the case of normal person when compared to the person with the ascites. So because of this ascites, there will be stretching of the abdomen. So if you look in the daylight, or we can see the tense, that is shining abdomen, the shiny abdomen, you can see the shiny abdomen. And also normally in every people, this umbilicus will be inverted. But in this case of ascites people, what happens is this umbilicus gets averted and it will be like smiling. This is also known as smiling umbilicus. So in normal people, you can see the inverted umbilicus. But in the case of ascites people, this umbilicus gets averted and it's in the smiling umbilicus. This is named as typically in ascites, we call it as smiling umbilicus. So careful differentiation of other causes of ascites is needed, and diagnosis paracentesis. And serum ascites to albumin gradient sag, that is greater than 1.1 gram per deciliter. If less than 1 gram per deciliter, then other causes are considered. So the treatment of ascites is mainly by diuretics and sodium restriction, that is less than 2 gram per day. So what is the term? We should know the term regarding the refractory ascites. What is meant by refractory ascites means? What happens means in this patient with cirrhosis, the ascites develops. So what happens is we repeatedly do paracentesis and we remove about 500 to 1 liter. And so what happens in this patient is again ascites develops. So when we will be terming this as this is refractory ascites means, if in the persistence of uses of diuretic, after persistent uses of diuretic, that is more than 120 gram per day, that then still the patient develop ascites means, then it is called as refractory ascites. So after the maximal treatment with the diuretics also, if the patient is not responding, then it is termed as refractory hypertension. So in ascitic refractory to medical therapy, large volume paracentesis is done. So paracentesis is nothing but this draining of the ascitic fluid. So if ascites progress despite large volume paracentesis, TIPS is considered. So coming to the third important clinical feature, that is esophageal varices. Engorged submucosal veins in lower esophagus and proximal stomach. 30% of the patients with cirrhosis develop varices, and the rate of development of varices in cirrhosis is approximately 5 to 15% per year. So this is very important. So why varices? So any hepatic disease that is cirrhosis, the patient ultimately develops varices. So what happens? We have to keep the patients on beta blocker, that is portal hypertension should be reduced. So we'll be keeping the patient on medical therapy, and then we'll be sending the patient for endoscopy. So upper GI endoscopy. So by this we can see the varices, greater varices. So we can prevent the rupture of the varices by either sclerotherapy and also by keeping the patient on medical therapy. So the screening esophagogastrodiagnoscopy, and the risk of developing bleeding from varices depends on severity of liver disease, patients with hepatovenous pressure gradient greater than 12 mm of Hg, previous episodes of variceal bleeding, size of varices, red blood cells. So how you will be assessing the patient with portal hypertension? So first, before assessing the portal hypertension person, we have to see the exact hepatic disease. What is the disease that this patient is suffering from? So exact first in the primary pathology within the liver, that is assessment of the liver disease and the assessment of the portal circulation and upper gastrointestinal endoscopy. Evaluation of the liver disease is, so coming to the first part, that is evaluation of liver disease, is based on the clinical findings and laboratory studies. Total bilirubin and liver enzymes increases, albumin get decreased and prothrombin time increase. So viral serology to rule out viral hepatitis. And the two important scoring systems for liver disease severity are the Child-Pugh score and the model of for end stage liver disease, that is MELD score. So Child-Pugh's classification of severity of cirrhosis, that is based on the parameters, that is encephalopathy, ascites, bilirubin, albumin, prothrombin time, that is seconds prolonged or INR ratio. Based on this, these are classified into point wise, that is 1, 2, 3, and depends if the points and score is based on these points, again they are classified into mild to moderate and severe, that is grade 1 or 2 or grade 3 or 4. So class A, that is 5 to 6, if the patient satisfies 5 to 6 points, then least severe liver disease. And if the class B, which is 7 to 9 points, that is moderately severe liver disease, and is claimed and termed as class C when the point is 10 to 15 points, that is most severe liver disease. So model for end stage liver disease score is calculated as, you can see the formula, that is serum creatinine plus total bilirubin plus INR plus 6.4, that is if the score is less than 10, then we can safely undergo elective surgery. If the score is 10 to 15, that may undergo surgery with caution. And if there is if it is more than 15, it should not be subjected to elective surgical procedures. So the second part, that is assessment of the portal circulation and vascular anatomy of liver, is by imaging techniques. So the imaging modalities that are available to us are ultrasound and Doppler, that is CT and MR angiography. The Doppler ultrasound can assess size, directional flow velocities and waveform patterns of the portal and hepatic veins, especially patency or thrombosis of the portal vein. The CT or MR angiography helps when Doppler findings are inconclusive or of any doubt. Coming to the second part of the investigation, that is upper GI endoscopy. All patients diagnosed are cirrhotic have to undergo upper GI. So why? As I mentioned previously, that is because of the cirrhosis, there will be long-standing complications like splenomegaly, esophageal varices, hemorrhoids. So for this, in the case of upper esophagus, whether that is esophageal varices, to know the esophageal varices, we have to go for the upper GI endoscopy. And these varices are classified depending on the endoscopic appearance. So see, how will we grade the varices? So grading of the varices, the size of the varices is small, that is two size classification, that is less than 5 mm. And three size, based on three size classification, that minimally elevated veins above the mucosal surface. If we will divide the grading as it's medium, when the tortuous veins occupy 1/3 of the lumen. If we will be terming as the varices as large, if the two size, in case of two size classification, that is more than 5 mm, or in case of three size classification, that is these tortuous veins occupying greater than 1/3 of the lumen. So the red signs or the red bell signs denote impending bleeding from the varices. So you can see the grade 1 varices, just there the tortuous veins, that is less than 5 mm. In the here we can see the grade 2, that is occupying the less than the 1/3 of the lumen. See, so here you can see the greater than 1/3 of the lumen occupying the under the greater than 1/3 of the lumen. These are the gradients of viruses. So these are the red signs. So coming to the treatment part, we have to treat the complications and the tips and sense procedures and liver transplant. So coming to the treatment of varices, there will be, that is primary prophylaxis, treatment of the acute bleeding, prevention of the rebleeding. So what is this primary prophylaxis? The primary prophylaxis means, so we have to treat the portal hypertension, that is we have to keep the patient on propranolol, that is around 25 milligrams dose every day. So we have to caution the patient because this propranolol may, this is the, because of this problem there will be hypotension. So in this, what happens in these patients, for reducing the portal vein pressure, there will be also systemic side effects like hypotension. So this is very, very important. Cautious, we have to monitor the patient very carefully. So the primary prophylaxis, treatment of acute bleeding, that is by bandage sclerotherapy or that by banding of the varices should be done. And again, the prevention of the rebleeding, that is prophylactically, we have to sclerotherapy or banding of the esophageal varices. So coming to the profile access, primary profile access, how we will be proceeding means we have to first screen through esophago gastrodiagnoscopy, and the profile access depends on the grade of abscess. So mentioned that grade 1, grade 2, grade 3. So if the grade 1 means less than 5 mm, and the grade 2 is that is occupying less than the 1/3 of the lumen, and the grade 3 is greater than the 1/3 of the lumen. So before the treatment, we have to grade the varices. And cirrhosis compensated or decompensated, that is we have to see whether the patient is in compensated state or the decompensated state. What is compensation and decompensation means? Compensation means the patient will be responding to the treatment. But in the case of decompensated state, this patient may not respond to the treatment. That is why we have to, it's very carefully, we have to assess the patient, whether mentioned earlier, that is, we should assess the patient in the liver disease very properly. Because in the case of decompensation state, if you treat the patient also, there will be no use. So that's why you have to grade the patient properly, and the pharmacological and endoscopic therapies include, that is pharmacological therapy consists of, that is I mentioned earlier, propranolol, that is non-selective beta blocker therapy, propranolol, nadolol, that is propranolol, that is 25 milligrams of milligrams dose of daily, we have to keep the patient primarily, and it is cost effective, reduces the risk of first hemorrhage by 45% and associated mortality by 50%, and have significant side effects like importance. So this is a main drawback, that is one of the important side effect of propranolol, because in the case of if the patient is in an age group of 35 years and he develops cirrhosis, as a result and finally may land in portal hypertension, the patient may keep the patient on propranolol importance, which is he will be in the family life age group. So that is very, very important. So this is one of the important side effects, that is importance. So non-responders and non-tolerated 20%. So coming to the endoscopic therapy, consists of endoscopic variceal ligation like or sclerotherapy, and performed for 1 to 2 weeks until obliteration, followed by esophago gastrodiagnoscopy 1 to 3 months following the procedure. And this endoscopic therapy controls variceal bleeding in 90% greater than 90% of patients, and reduces the risk and has minimal side effects when compared to beta blocker therapy, but is more costly and not easily available in developing countries. So patients with compensated cirrhosis and no varices, no profile access, screening esophago gastrodiagnoscopy every 3 years, and patients with small varices and no increased risk, and beta blockers can be used but benefit not established, and having increased risk, beta blocker therapy and repeat esophago gastroscopy every 2 years. So in the third one, that patients with cirrhosis and medium or large varices, no increased risk, beta block, if there is no increased risk, then beta blocker therapy is considered with annual screening esophageal gastroduodenoscopy. And in the case of if contraindication or non-compliance, then EVL sclerotherapy is needed. If he has increased risk, then we have to prophylactically, we have to go for endoscopic variceal ligation or sclerotherapy is considered. So how will we manage the pace if the patient suddenly is a known cirrhotic patient and he came to the suddenly casualty with the bouts of hematemesis, and if you done endoscopy, then there will be acute variceal bleeding. So what in that condition, what exactly you have to do? So initially we have to resuscitate and admit to the ICU, and immediately we see for the hemoglobin. If the hemoglobin is less than 8 g/dL, then we have to immediately go for the blood transfusion. And we have to correct the coagulopathy, that is we have to give fresh frozen plasma or the fresh platelets, and we have to give prophylactic antibiotics, and combined pharmacological and endoscopic treatment, and the tracheal intubation may be needed in cases of massive bleed to secure airway and prevent aspiration. So coming to the pharmacological therapy, consists of vasopressin and analogs, somatostatin and analogs, and beta blocker therapy for this acute variceal bleeding. So coming to see one by one we'll see. So the emergency scheme, if variceal hemorrhage is suspected, means first we have to, the resuscitation measures should be done, that is IV volume support, blood transfusion, antibiotic prophylaxis, that is up to 7 days, that is oral norfloxacin 400 milligram BID dose, or IV ciprofloxacin or IV ceftriaxone, that is 1 g/day in advance of cirrhosis. Pharmacological therapy should be continued for about 2 to 5 days after confirming diagnosis. Terlipressin 2 milligram every 4 hours, or somatostatin or octreotide or vaporetide. So what next 20 to 24 hours, what we should do within 12 hours, confirm the diagnosis with esophageal gastroduodenoscopy, and treat the variceal hemorrhages with endoscopic variceal ligation or sclerotherapy. In uncontrollable bleeding or recurrence, TIPS is indicated. In uncontrolled bleeding, while waiting for TIPS or endoscopic therapy, balloon tamponade should be done immediately. So this is an important one. This balloon tamponade has temperature measure for 44 hours maximum. So what is coming to luminal tamponade? This is what is a luminal tamponade? When medical and endoscopic measures fail to control varicose hemorrhage, balloon tamponade using a sensitized Blackmore tube will control refractory bleeding in up to 90% of patients. So however, its application is limited due to the potential for complications, which include aspiration, airway obstruction, esophageal perforation due to overinflation or trus necrosis. So the balloon, this gastric balloon is inflated first by 200 ml of air and pulled upwards to press the gastric fundus. If bleeding continues, the esophageal balloon is inflated. Then the pressure in the esophageal balloon should be 30 to 40 mm of Hg. This therapy is effective in controlling bleeding in 80-90% of cases. See what exactly this balloon tamponade may see, as I mentioned earlier, after the confirmation of the diagnosis, that is a varicose bleeding again. So this balloon tamponade, so this is a procedure in which we have temporarily we have to stall the blood, that is hemorrhage, that is the balloon portal, that is. So we have to remember this pressure. So the pressure within this esophageal balloon should be 30 to 40 mm. What happens if the pressure increases? As in the previous slide I mentioned, see, you can see there will be perforation due to overinflation or pressure necrosis. That's why this pressure should be controlled very effectively. And also how much of ml of air that should be inflated first, that is 200 ml of air. So you can see there's a different types of tamponades, that is Linton, Blackmore, Minnesota. These are important. So these names are important. Linton, Blackmore, tamponade, Minnesota. So coming to the secondary prophylaxis, combined endoscopic and pharmacological therapies are used. Therapies are used on long-term endoscopic control with banding or sclerotherapy of recurrent varices every 3 to 6 months. Non-selective beta blocker therapy starting at low dose and increasing until resting heart rate decreases by 25%, but not below 55 beats per minute. If combined therapy fails, patient is not compliant, TIPS or other shunt procedure is considered, especially if patient is a transplant candidate. Transjugular intrahepatic portal shunt. So this is a TIPS procedure. If the in case of this is endoscopic variceal ligation, everything failed, in spite of again the patient is re-bleeding, there is a final procedure that you have to go for is transjugular intrahepatic portal shunt. So coming to improper, that is TIPS procedure involves implantation of a metallic stent between an intrahepatic branch of the portal vein and a hepatic vein radicle, and the needle track is dilated until a portal pressure gradient of less than 12 mm Hg is achieved, and controls varicose bleeding in greater than 90% of cases refractory to medical treatment. So the major advantage of the TIPS is that it is non-operative approach. Portal vein patency must be established conclusively before procedure, and some of the disadvantages of TIPS are, there is shunt occlusion. So what happens, there will be occlusion within the shunt that at the end of the first year in 50% of the patients. This thrombosis are, that is neo-intimal hyperplasia. Secondary to this, there will be occlusion and the high incidence of hepatic encephalopathy. In the previous class we discussed what happens in hepatic encephalopathy. This patient will be in ultrasound serum, and because of there will be proteins are not handled properly by the liver, these ammonium ions gets they diverted through the portal vein into the brain. There will they damage the astrocytes, or the cell by there will be edema within the cell, and there will be lysis. Finally, the patient may present with ultrasound serum and neurological neuropsychiatric complications, and the severe hemorrhage in case of puncture of extrahepatic portal vein. These are the disadvantages. The TIPS is best suited to provide short-term portal system decompression, and patients most suitable for TIPS are liver transplant candidates who fail endoscopic or pharmacological therapy. So this line is important. The patients most suitable for TIPS are liver transplant candidates who fail endoscopic or pharmacological therapies. So coming to the surgical therapies, that is portosystemic shunt procedures, devascularization procedures, liver transplant. So portosystemic shunts, these portosystemic shunt procedures aim to decompress the portal system to varying degrees by shunting portal blood to systemic vessels. Most of the shunt procedures today are only historically significant. Surgical shunt procedures today are considered only if the patient has severe liver disease, not a transplant candidate, does not have access to TIPS, and prognosis mainly depends on hepatic reserve. surgical shunt procedures are classified as non-selective shunts, selective shunts and partial shunts. So the non-selective shunts are aimed to decompress the portal system by completely diverting the portal blood flow, and it's also called as total shunts. So the end-to-side portal cavern, end-to-side anastomosis ex fistula. In classic end-to-end portal cavern shunt, the portal vein is divided close to the hilum of the liver and the splanchnic and anastomose to the side of the vena cava, and this decompresses the portal hypertension but leaves the obstructed sinuses under high pressure. It will not relieve ascites but will control variceal bleeding. See, just remember these are not, you may not remember all these things, just remember the side heading. There is, they ask for, if you are in the case of writing a question, you should just remember the surgical shunt procedures are classified as, because in the undergraduate level, if you remember these shunts, it's enough. There is non-selective shunts, selective shunts and partial shunt. So coming to this side-to-side anastomosis, side-to-side shunts are either direct vein-to-vein anastomosis or wide interposition graft. Intact under upper end of the portal vein serves as a decompressive outflow from the high pressure that is obstructed liver sinusoids. Hence, in addition to controlling variceal bleeding, these shunts are also control ascites. Convention, this is conventional spleno-renal shunt. So proximal spleno-renal shunt, conventional spleno-renal shunts involve splenectomy and end-all side anastomosis of proximal end of the splenic vein to left renal vein. And major disadvantages, shunt stenosis and thrombosis. So control, these shunts control variceal bleeding effectively. The major drawbacks of the total shunts, all the shunts are the loss of portal circulation to liver, accelerated hepatic failure, high incidence of hepatic encephalopathy. So up to now we have discussed regarding the non-selective shunts. Now coming to the selective shunts. So just remember this. Now what selective shunts? Selective shunts aim is to decompress the esophagogastric varices and preserve the portal blood flow to liver, and maintain residual portal hypertension and distal spleno-renal shunt. So here, so you can see the distal spleno-renal shunt. So this distal spleno-renal shunt means the distal part of the splenic vein is anastomosed to the left renal vein. It is introduced by Warren, decompresses the gastrospleenic circulations, but high pressure in mesenteric and portal veins persist, does not relieve, rather aggravates ascites. So it controls the variceal bleeding in 90 to 95%, and portal perfusion maintained in greater than 90% in non-alcoholic liver disease, but only 50% in alcoholic liver disease. Incidence of encephalopathy reduced to 15%, technically more difficult than total shunts. Coming to partial shunts, objectives are, I know this is a dry topic, but try to remember just the names, because portal hypertension is per se, it's mainly, primarily we will be treating in the medicine part only, medical part, but these surgical aspects you may not write if the question is asked within the medicine paper, you may not write. If it is asked in the surgery paper, you have to write this regarding the surgery parts also. Objectives are same as selective shunts and different from selective shunt in that splenic and mesenteric blood flows are not divided from one another, and previously narrow vein to vein side on anastomosis were done, and either thrombus or dilator become total shunt. Recently, small caliber interposition grafts are being used and controlled variceal bleeding in 90% and maintained portal perfusion in 80%. Coming to the final part, that is devascularization procedures. These procedures aim to interrupt the inflow to varices. Sugura approach, modified Sugura approach, esophageal devascularization without splenectomy. Remember this name, just a note. So ultimate, that is the final part of the treatment part, that is liver transplant, definitive treatment of for any end stage liver disease, only therapy that addresses underlying liver disease and very expensive and donor organs are not readily available.
Thank you.